Being people who do not have school out there.
There's a lot of good ones on the board for you.
Well, welcome back, everybody. Let's start with prayer. And we'll go into our subject tonight. Father, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity once again to come together this evening as a class so that we can learn how to interpret your word. And Father, if there's anything vying for our attention, I pray that we would be disciplined enough to lay those aside so that we can concentrate tonight as we study the material. And Father, if we have any sins, we know how important it is to be in fellowship. And because of this, we utilize 1 John 1:9, which says that if we confess our sins to you, you are faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us, Father, to concentrate and to pay attention. And we pray this in Christ's name.
Amen.
All right, let's pick up from where we left off last week, which is page 207. This is part of last week's reading. And on page 207, remember, reading handled with care. Keep in mind that the problem, if there are any, is not with the scripture, but rather the interpretation of the scripture. There's always going to be problems, right? There's always going to be varied interpretations of scripture. You know, all you have to do is listen online, listen on the radio, and inevitably someone will disagree or someone is going to interpret a passage of scripture which is different from yours or even mine. And so if that's the case, the problem is never with God's word. It's always with the interpreter of God's word. So we need to keep that in the back of our minds. The reason why I say this, although this is very elementary for us here, there are people who will sometimes question Christianity because they say that the Bible doesn't make sense. How could a woman give birth to a child and never had a relationship with a man? You know, did a big fish really swallow Jonah? You know, and there's a whole bunch of things, and so they can't understand these things. And so they think that the Bible has issues. They'll say things like, well, the Bible contradicts itself. In the Old Testament, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. So if someone hits you, you have the right to hit back. And but now, when you look in the New Testament, what's the mandate? If someone strikes you in the cheek, turn the other cheek. You see? So there's a contradiction. There's no contradiction. This is how things work out over time. In the Old Testament, there is civil law. In the New Testament, Christ introduced grace, which is really, the protocol of God himself. Is it not true that we should be headed for hell, the lake of fire? But because of grace, he extends forgiveness as a result of his Son, Jesus Christ. So he also mentions the hazards to avoid, and he gives six pitfalls to avoid. The first one is John 14:6. If Jesus says, I am the way, but you read it as, I am a way, you are misreading the text, right?
Yep.
And some people will say, well, Jesus was a great teacher, he was a great prophet, he was a way, but not the way. So it's very important to see that if you misunderstand or misread the text, then you're going to run into all kinds of problems. And it's just a matter of time before someone is going to get frustrated. Okay? Take a look at the next example. He cites 1 Timothy 6:10. I think you're familiar with this verse, right? For the love of money is the root of all evil.
Oops.
You've read that verse before? Now, how many times have you heard someone say, money is the root of all evil?
Yeah.
How many of you have used that before? Money is not the root of all evil. It's the love of money. See, that's misreading the text. If you say money is the root of all evil, that's not what the text says. You're misinterpreting the scripture. And that alone will go a long way, and it will frustrate you, your family, your friends. They don't want to be around you because you're holding up the scripture and saying, well, money is the root of all evil, and you're making a lot of money, therefore you're
evil.
Maybe you're not saved. You know, there's a whole bunch of things that float around us, and that's not the right way to read the text. Just read it for what it says. What does it say? The love of money is the root of all evil. Not money. Money is not evil. It's how we use money. In fact, whether you have a little or a lot, it depends on you. Whether or not it's going to be used for things that are considered evil. Right? What if you only have $10 but you spend it on something that's wrong? So it's not money at all. It's just an item. It's just a way, a medium for exchange. Mm-hmm. But how you use that determines whether or not it's right or wrong. Even a half a penny can go far with God. Remember what Jesus said? Oh, she put everything she got. You know, she gave everything she got. So it's not the amount. It's where your focus is on. Are you so fixated on getting more money? So your allegiance is to either God or to mammon, God or money. And money, making lots of money, there's nothing wrong so long as God is first. But if you put priority in money and you say, oh, well, God understands. No, he doesn't. He said the love of money is the root of all evil. Okay, so again, that's misreading the text. And we have to learn how to read. And ignorance of the text is the unpardonable sin of interpretation. And this is the primary discipline of observation. So that's the first hazard to avoid. The second hazard is what? It's called
distorting
the text. In other words, making the text say something that it's not. It's one thing to struggle with the interpretation. It's another thing to distort the meaning of God's word. So you don't want to distort the text and make it say something it's not saying. You know, thus saith the Lord. And if you go around and pronounce on his behalf and God never said that, you're in trouble. James tells us, you know, let not all of us be teachers. Because people just gravitate towards people who are charismatic and those who are preaching the word or teaching the word. They want hope. They want encouragement. They want to know that what they're believing in is trustworthy. They want to know that God loves them in spite of. And when you insert and sprinkle some truth with half-truths, to benefit you, you're in trouble. You're going to be in trouble. And that's why not everyone is cut out to be teachers. And we don't want to distort the text. God will judge us swiftly, those who are mishandling the text. In fact, let's just turn there quickly. I know we've looked at this recently.
Which one?
James.
Oh, yeah.
Chapter 3. For those online, James chapter 3, verse 1, my brethren. So he's talking to who?
The believers.
Believers, right? So it's safe to say that it applies to us. Let not many of you become teachers, knowing that we shall receive stricter judgment. Okay? And then he continues to talk about the tongue. For if we all stumble in many things, if anyone does not stumble in word, he is a mature man, a perfect man, able to bridle the whole body. So it's something about the choice of words that's very difficult to control. So he's saying in verse 2, we all stumble in many things, but if anyone does not stumble in word, what he says, he's a perfect man or a mature man, able also to bridle the whole body. That's why when you listen to someone and you compare people by what they say, sometimes you can discern or you can determine where they're coming from, right?
Oh, yeah.
So you can tell, okay, this guy seems like he knows what he's talking about just by the choice of words. That's the same thing with what James is saying here. Indeed, we put bits in horses' mouths that they may obey us, and we turn their whole body, mm-hmm. just with their mouth, right? The entire horse moves when we are able to control what? The mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And look also at ships. Although they are so large and are driven by fierce winds, they are turned in the very small rudder whenever the pilot desires. So it's a small rudder that controls the ship. It's the mouth of a huge horse that controls a horse. Mm-hmm. And he continues, look at what it says in verse 5. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasts great things. See how great a forest a little fire kindles. And the tongue is a fire, it is a world of iniquity. The tongue is so set among our members that it defiles the whole body and sets on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire by hell.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty strong words, see? And it continues to talk about, look, verse 8, no man can tame the tongue. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. With it we bless our God and Father, and with it we curse men who has been made in the image or similitude of God. So I better stop reading. It's pointing fingers at all of us, huh? So the point is, we got to be careful with what we say. And going back to distorting the text, we don't want to make it say something it's not saying. That's what's important. And then number 3, contradicting the text. This error is even worse than textual distortion. It's basically calling God a liar. The serpent contradicted God's word in the Garden of Eden. Remember? It's a major contradiction, right? Did God really say that? No, he didn't. He knows that you'll be like him, knowing good from evil. You know? So it's contradicting. And the key there is, you'll be like him. No, they won't. You can't have... There's always going to be a creature and creator distinction. Right? The creator makes the creature. That's us. There will always be that distinction. Okay? So what the serpent was saying is that you'll be like the creator. He knows that when you partake of this fruit, you're going to be like him. And it appealed to the woman. Right? Subjectivism. Hendrick says they wander around the scriptures waiting for a liver quiver to tell them when they struck pay dirt. I guess that's one of those words, phrases that they would use back then.
Just going back here, mm-hmm. here's the thing that I had to use last night when talking to another person at 11 o'clock. I asked, you know, does God reward faith and good behavior with material prosperity?
Yeah.
It's like, are you... You know, controlling God now, but by good your good behavior for him to pay you back.
Yeah, yeah.
Bless you with quote unquote blessings.
Right. There's a lot of people that make the, you know, they arrive at, you know, well, if I'm a good person, then therefore God is going to reward me or bless me. And the truth is that he blesses based solely on his integrity.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Sometimes we don't deserve it, but he blesses us anyway.
Yeah.
Sometimes we deserve to be caught. We deserve to be punished. We deserve a no, but God says yes.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not necessarily linked with our obedience to him. We obey him because we love him. If you love me, obey me.
Mm-hmm.
We don't improve our behavior because with the intention of getting him to give us something. God, if I commit for the year 2012 and I improve myself, can you give me that car? We're supposed to be good and we're supposed to obey, period.
Yeah.
I mean, we owe him our lives plus more. I mean, he has saved us from eternal separation, right? We have to remember where we were headed prior to conversion. That's huge. Mm-hmm. We will never, ever, ever have to worry about our spiritual destiny. We're going to be with him one day. So when people look around and they say, how come my neighbors are getting away with all this stuff? How come they keep getting bigger houses, more cars, they've got the jumbo jets or their private jets, and I'm still having a hard time? Well, you won't forever. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you both die tomorrow, and one of you is a believer, you're a believer and they're not, it doesn't matter what they have. What shall a man profit if he gains it all, gains the whole world, but forfeits his soul? So when you start wondering where's God during those rough points, he's there. And just don't compare yourself and don't say, well, if I improve my behavior, maybe, you know, like Santa Claus, he's going to give me something. He's not Santa Claus. He will give you based on his integrity, his grace. See? And that's far superior than rewarding us every time we do something. Because it's not that he's locked to and watching us and saying, oh gosh, I got to give him something now. He was a good boy today. No, it's not healthy. We have to factor in our love for him, right? There's got to be something we can steward. Why can't we just do things because we love him? He first loved us. Is there anything wrong with wanting things? No, that's what prayer is for. That's the reason why we can go out, call out to him in prayer. You want that car? Why don't you pray about it? Go to him in prayer and say, Lord, I don't know if this is selfish of me, but I really do want that red car. Here are the reasons why. I know that you know them already, but I want to be transparent before you. I want that red car because my car is starting to show signs that is breaking down. And so whether it's this red car or something better or something that you think is appropriate, I'm open. I just want you to know that I have a family and my car is not as reliable as it used to be. Would you please consider my petition? And I'm thanking you in advance because whether it's a yay or a nay, I still love you. What's wrong with that? Not, well, I'm gonna really start reading my Bible tonight. And every night I'm going to show God, look what I'm reading, Lord. Look what I'm reading.
No, a lot of people do it
because of our love for him. You know, it's just how it is with a relationship. Any relationship that's deep and meaningful. You don't do it because you're expecting something. You do it because you love that person. Mm-hmm. Right? It's no different when we talk about a relationship with God. He says there's nothing wrong with having an emotional response to God's word. Just keep in mind that the meaning of the text is in the text, not in our subjective or emotional response to the text. What he's talking about here is sometimes people get all emotional when they start reading the text. Sometimes they'll say, well, the Lord guided me to this one passage of scripture, and I felt something. You know, I've learned that I don't disagree with that person anymore. I'm more interested in what did they get when they read. So just know that there's not always going to be an emotional response. Sometimes you're tired, you're fatigued, and so when you read the scripture, see, the problem with always being emotional when you're reading is that what happens when you're not? Now the problem is between you and yourself. And God, you're going to sit there and say, well, I didn't really feel anything today. Is God, are you still there? All of a sudden it's his fault, right?
Yeah.
Where are you, Lord? I don't feel your presence. I ask you to join me. Lord, fill us with your spirit. That's incorrect because we're always filled with him. We're always indwelt. But when we're out of fellowship, he doesn't leave us. He's just not operating in us. Like a relationship between husband and wife. You're still there, you see each other, but non-operational. right? You go by each other, two ships passing.
The hallway.
You're still there. It doesn't, you know, if someone on the outside of the family were to ask, you still love your wife? Oh, yeah. Still love your husband? Oh, yeah. You guys getting along? Oh, no way. Not right now. Mm. That happens. And that's the truth. That's the reality with our relationship with God. And if it does, if we do get to the point, and if you are having an emotional response, then just know that the problem with that is that when you read it and you don't have that response, then you are going to start to question yourself and Him. I didn't feel Him today. Well, see, that's the problem with being responding in a subjective fashion. We're never told to feel God's presence. Did you know that?
Supposed
There's nowhere in Scripture that says you will feel God's presence. We will know that He's with us based on truth, objective truth. So, you know, regardless of how we feel, we are to focus in on the things that remind us of the reality of His presence. Philippians 4 comes to mind. We've got to go to Him in prayer with thanksgiving, supplication, and petition. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, is going to guard your hearts and minds in Christ. See? So it's there. It's designed to stabilize us. So that when we sense, for whatever reason, we're just not feeling our best, that happens, then we can go to Him and say, I don't know what's going on. Maybe it's that time of the month for the female. Maybe it's just your sugar levels are off. You forgot to take your meds. That's not God. That's you. And we don't want to blur that and say, well, I don't sense God today. And that's why we're never told to gauge our relationship on our feelings. I'm all for feelings, Winston.
Isn't the feeling, doesn't the feeling go hand in hand if love is an emotion, a feeling?
Well, love, by biblical definition, is not a feeling. It's a principle. If you look at 1 Corinthians 13, biblical love is patience, kindness, you know. There are, if you want to see what love is, I think God's love, the way He defines it is in 1 Corinthians 13. Now, emotions should flow from a biblical understanding of love. So that when you see someone, when you see your child doing something wrong, you should be angry. That's the emotional response. Mm-hmm. But that's because you love your child. You don't want him to go out and hurt himself. And so you're telling him, don't go out tonight. It's late. And, you know, you're sleepy. And, you know, if you get into an argument with your son or your daughter, that's love. Mm-hmm. You care.
You care.
You see? So when we say love is emotional, usually, in the minds of many, it's a good feeling. But love is multifaceted. It has a lot of emotions involved with love. But look at 1 Corinthians 13, and you'll see. Let me just read it for you, so you can see that it's more of a commitment than an emotion.
Yeah.
See, love, for verse 4, 1 Corinthians 13, 4, love suffers long, okay, and is kind, does not envy, does not parade itself, is not puffed up or arrogant, does not, what? Behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails.
Why did they always use that for a marriage ceremony?
Because, I use it as well, because it's a picture of what biblical love is. Mm-hmm. Now, when some use it, it's just kind of a standard format. They just, yeah. Oh yeah, okay, love is kind, love is patient. But when I go through it, I kind of explain what it means. And what I'll do is, during when I officiate weddings, I insert their names so they can personalize it.
Yeah.
So it'll be like, Rafi suffers long, Liza is kind. Rafi does not envy, and Liza does not parade herself. Rafi is not puffed up. You see what I'm saying? Is that I'll now show them what it's like to personalize biblical love. So you say you're going to love your wife till death do you part. What does that actually mean? Does that mean you're going to feel passionate towards your spouse for the rest of your life? That's not always going to be the case.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if that's all you're hanging your relationship on, it's going to go sour, and then you're just going to want to just, you know what, just sign on the dotted line. There's got to be substance. It's got to be more than just feelings.
Yeah.
That's why when I officiate the wedding, I tell the couple, prior to that, even in premarital counseling, this is the picture of biblical love. And if you want to go the distance and you don't want to be a statistic, well, here's what true love is. Not a feeling, because they're holding hands, they're so much in love, oh no, we'll never fight. And then like 6 months later, I check up on them, oh, they're having a, they're falling apart. And I said, well, I told you, first 3 years, 1 to 3 years is going to be rough. It's going to be nice in the beginning, but then all of a sudden you're going to wake up and say, that's how she looks like in the morning? I didn't know that. He sleeps like that?
Snoring so no night.
I didn't know that. I like my peace and quiet. Yeah. See? Jasmine, did you have a question? Or, well, Winston?
Why are you guys looking at each other? I noticed.
So, but that's what how I would present 1 Corinthians 13. Anybody that I officiate, if I marry someone, I want them to know what it means to really love the person. And I always tell them, look, emotions are great, but it should always be supported with biblical love. You got to know what it means to love your spouse. Because I'm telling you, people get married, it's just all emotional. Oh, you are the most handsome, you're the prettiest. And they're telling me with tears in their eyes. And they said, you know what, it's been 6 months, 8 months, every time we see each other, it's the same. It's only getting stronger. I said, no, that's just, you're attracted to each other. Okay? But the moment that wears off, you've got to have something that's going to keep you going. And that's the problem with weddings today. That's why, look at the movie stars. They get married, they enjoy it because they've got all this fame, they got all this money. So they can just kind of pick and choose who they want to marry this time. You know, she's really cute, he's really good looking. They get married and they get to know each other. It's like, you're not like that on TV. I know the real you. I want a divorce and I want half. See? But love is not just feelings. In fact, it's not about feelings. It's about commitment. I mean, you could see this in the person of Jesus towards humanity. Mm-hmm. And when I present this to couples, I say, this is how you should view each other. And if you can't, maybe we need to spend a little more time sorting through things, which is healthy. Doesn't mean that you don't love each other. I'm just showing you that don't base it on your feelings towards each other. Because once you get married, you go through this honeymoon phase, and then a period of adjustment phase, and then all of a sudden, there's... It's funny because at my house, in my housing tract, I see these two couples almost every day walking the dog. They must be in their 70s. It's nice to watch. It's cute and funny to watch them because they're at least 20 feet apart. It's like they don't want to be next to each other. They got the dog. So every time, I've never seen them together. They're just kind of, you know, pacing. They want to make sure there's a 20-foot gap
between
the two. And I don't understand why they would walk apart from each other, but they got their dog and they're happy, and I just see them every time. They're not even looking at each other. So I think they're just,
stuck together.
They're stuck. They've been together for so long, so it's just.
So why rattle the boat?
Yeah. So I, you know, and it's never too late. We have relationships. We hear about this all the time. You know, we've been married for a long time. I don't have that fire anymore. I don't have the feelings anymore. And that's why I said, if I would have known you from the very beginning of your relationship, I would have told you it's not your feelings that will keep you together. Because mixed in with the feelings of, you know, desiring for one another, you know, and loving one another, you're going to fight. And then if you can't take it anymore, you're going to say, you know what, I don't feel like I'm in love anymore. Basically, you're saying you're just not happy.
Yeah.
It's not based, and it should never be built on how you feel. What do you think God would have done if he used his emotions? If God said, you know what, I'm tired of this. You guys are just really upsetting me. I'm done. You promised me 2012 you're going to change. But you're not.
Let me just zap you.
I'll take you home now.
I'll talk to Robert today.
Just kidding. So, just kidding. Nothing wrong with emotional responses to the scripture and even having emotions. I think we're all emotional in one way or another. Just don't let that guide you, especially when we're talking about God's word. Okay. Sometimes you'll feel good, sometimes you won't, and that sometimes happens. Nothing wrong. You're not. It's nothing odd about that at all. Number five, relativism. Some think that scriptures change over time. The text meant one thing back when it was written, but something else today. Its meaning is relative. It fluctuates. And some dismiss the resurrection as being spiritual rather than physical or literal. We see this a lot with the cults, right? Jesus, yeah, he rose from the dead, but it was more spiritual. He didn't rise physically. He rose spiritually. JWs are fond of saying that. Another hazard or pitfall to avoid is what's called overconfidence.
Yeah.
If you have your Bibles, take a look at Proverbs 16:18. If someone can read that. Proverbs 16:18. What's it say? Proverbs 16:18.
Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall.
What's a haughty spirit? Just so we're on the same page. Do you know what a haughty spirit is?
Yeah, watch this. Huh? Proverbs what?
16:18. It's having a big ego. You know, I'm the man.
Yeah.
It's a haughty spirit, right? Pride goes before destruction. We can see that with Satan, right? So pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. We've got to back off on the ego. We've got to back off on the pride. Sometimes it creeps in. It's part of our sin nature at times. But we have to remember that it's not about how we view ourselves. It's how he views us. And we've got to continue to operate in a spirit of humility, because if Jesus did it and we're Christ-like, then so should we. Right? Nothing wrong with being humble. Nothing wrong with being knowledgeable or smart, but just be careful, because if you're not careful, as Proverbs says, it comes before destruction or a fall. The minute you think you've mastered a portion of Scripture, you are setting yourself up for a fall. Why? 1 Corinthians 8:1 says, knowledge puffs up. That's why, you know, every time we cover a Friendship Sunday or one of our Bible studies, we don't have to go and look for something profound and dig somewhere in Revelation and say, let's find some nugget of truth. A lot of times it's just the things that we're familiar with. Going over the text and reading it slowly and saying, I know I've read this 1,000 times, but maybe 1,001 I'm going to see something different tonight or today. Right? So never say to yourself, I already know this, I don't need to read it. Because, you know, we have those moments where we miss things. No matter how intent we're looking at the Scripture, we could miss things, and that could make a big difference. Just like misreading the text, right? Money is the root of all evil. Nobody does that on purpose. But a lot of people say that. If a lot of people say that, then it seems like that's our nature to just read it and then all of a sudden arrive at a conclusion and say, oh, well, obviously money is the root of all evil. And then you go around and you start judging people. You start pointing the finger. Supposedly in a loving fashion.
Hey, supposedly.
You know what, brother, sister, I'm concerned about you. I see you putting a lot of time. I don't see you on church on Sunday. You're working, huh? You can't love God and mammon. So you bring all these verses that talk about money, and then you preach a sermon or you have a special Bible study for your friend or friends who don't show up on Sunday. Oh, I'm glad you're here for the study. It just so happens I didn't prepare it for you guys. It just so happens that, you know, the subject tonight is putting God first.
Manipulation.
Especially on Sunday. So hope you enjoy the Bible study. I've seen that.
I've seen it too many times.
But God doesn't do that. And again, we're just, the idea is you don't want to be overconfident in the Scripture. The Word of God is alive, right? It's His Word, so we need to humble ourselves before it. We have the right to disagree, and obviously we provide that opportunity here at the church and even during class. And Dr. Hendricks reminds us that although there's only one interpretation, you'll encounter Christians who will often disagree with you. And differences in interpretation is okay so long as we understand and recognize that the tension is not with the Word of God, but in our limited understanding of the text. Mm-hmm. You will always view Scripture differently from someone else. Mm-hmm. That's just the nature of Bible study. You go to another Bible study and you a typical format, you get in a big circle, you have your study booklet open, you write down one word answers, and that's supposedly your study. And even with the answers, when you finally get into a discussion, someone is going to say, yeah, I read the book and I see what the author is saying, but I think it means this. Then everybody closes their book and they start telling you, well, I think it means this. I think it means this.
It's a commentary session.
And so that's usually what will happen if someone there isn't in charge, who is knowledgeable enough to use the rules that we're learning in this book and say, hey, let's go back to the basics. Huh? Who is he talking to? Mm-hmm. What is he talking about? Where is this? Is this in the Old Testament, New Testament? When was this? Why did this come out? And does this even apply to us? Now you've got everybody focused on the questions, and surely you're going to be able to together say, oh yeah, this is written to the church. Oh no, this is written to Israel. And then you can say, well, because the Beatitudes, are we supposed to do that today? Mm-hmm. Blessed is the kind, blessed is the poor in spirit. You know, and that we're supposed to do that today. A lot of churches say that. And I'm not saying that's necessarily wrong. But if you look closely, you'll see that Jesus was talking about how this is part of the kingdom that was supposed to be forthcoming. Those are principles during the millennial kingdom now. But, you know, if you open it up and allow everybody to give their 2 cents, you're going to get more than 2 cents.
25 cents.
Nothing wrong with disagreeing, but just as long as, you know, you apply these rules, at least you'll be able to say, okay, I see where you guys are coming from, but here's what I can see. And then you can apply these principles. Who, what, where, when, why? How does this apply to me? Look at the charts on 212. This is something to read when you have a chance. What does the Bible really say? You see that chart? What some people say? We've covered the first one, right? Money is the root of all evil. What does the Bible say? Well, the love of money is the root of all evil. Jesus never claimed to be God. Well, Jesus was calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God, John 5. I and the Father are one, John 10, right? We are all gods or part of God. Did you know that there are people who believe that we are gods? Or men are going to become gods? Anybody know who believes that?
I read the newspaper.
Newspaper?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, they're a huge cult, and they're known as the Mormon Church. Right? Jesus was just a great moral teacher. But these have been written. Well, here's what the Bible says, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. You see? So this will be a good chart to commit to memory when you have a chance, because these are what people are saying on the left-hand side, and the right-hand side shows us what the text says, what the Bible says, okay? Going on with chapter 29, page 213, actually 214, he talks about literary genre, which is crucial to interpretation. Unless you know what types of literature you are looking at, you are in no position to determine their meaning. Remember, we talked about the different types of genre, different types of books in the Bible. Like we know that Numbers, the book of Numbers, is quite different from, say, Proverbs, right? We know that the book of John is a little different from the book of Revelation, right? Romans is different from Acts. Acts is the beginning of the New Testament church. Romans is a doctrinal, it's a loaded book with good doctrine. And then he talks about the six major genres on page 215. The first one, these are good to know. The first one is, what's it? What is it called? What does it call?
Exposition.
This is more of an argument or explanation of a body of truth. It moves from point to point in a logical fashion. Paul's letters are good examples of expositional form in Scripture. And Hendricks says that these expositional books are perfect for Bible studies and in-depth studies, because their truths are inexhaustible. See? So that's exposition. And we do most of our teaching and preaching is in that format, exposition. Then there, another genre is narratives, right? Narratives and biography. Narrative means story. The story of creation can be found in what? What book?
Genesis.
And the Bible is full of stories. Is there a favorite story of yours? Can you think of a story in the Bible that you really, really enjoy or appreciate? What comes to mind? If you had to pick a story out of the Scripture, what story stands out?
Noah.
Noah. Why Noah?
The collection of the animals. They survive.
How do you get all those animals in the boat? Well, for me, I like Noah. I'd be interested in the details, too, of Noah. But I'd be interested in how did he get that huge barge?
Yeah.
How did he make that? Tree sap, when you read the scripture, sap from the trees. I mean, it took a long time to build that. But he did it. And it survived a global flood. He didn't have, you know, look at the Titanic. God can't sink it, they said. It went down. Yeah. This was a global flood, and God instructed Noah, and he built this huge ark, or this barge, and took two of every kind of animals, and several of different kinds, and was able to load it onto this huge ark. Now they're saying, some people say, well, we think we see it, Mount Ararat, or Turkey.
Yeah.
They've got these cameras that, and nobody really knows. Every time someone pursues the expedition, something happens, or it turns out to be false. So, but whatever the case, it doesn't change the fact that it happened. What I've done in the past is when I've gone to like forest homes, when I went to some of these retreats when I was younger, I was told that if I would just crack enough rocks up on these elevated areas, you'll find fossils. And I said, really? Up here in the mountains? And they said, yeah. And thus proving creation and the global flood. So here I was hammering away, and sure enough, eventually I hit a rock, and there's a plant, a leaf, trilobites, you know, little.
Yeah.
And I'm sitting here saying, well, how does this prove anything? They said, well, how, you know, it's up here. We're here in the mountain. We're here up here in the mountains. We're way up here. And there's no water around, so this proves that this was once, at a point in time, submerged in water. Mm-hmm. And then this is where I learned that the next thing they said was, how do you get a fossil? So we were sitting in a big circle, and we were talking about it, and they said, well, how do you create a fossil? And nobody knew. And so the instructor said, well, let's just look at the ocean. What happens when a fish dies? Well, it floats.
Sinks.
Then eventually it sinks. You know, other fish will eat it, parts of it, right? And eventually, there's still some parts of the fish, it drops to the bottom. And scavengers eat the rest, and then eventually it decomposes. So how do you get this fossil? And the only explanation, which it was riveted in my mind even back then, 7th or 8th grade, I think. The guy said, well, the only explanation is if you take all this mud and pack it immediately with lots and lots of pressure to preserve it, that's the only way you can possibly create a fossil. Because if not, it will decompose. So that matches the scripture. That matches what occurred in Genesis, global flood. Everything was tossing and turning, and thousands of tons compressing whatever was there. And you see that all around. All you have to do is dig long enough. I've haven't tested every mountain. But I've been told that if you dig long enough and crack enough rocks, you will find things. Fossils, schools of fish. I've seen pictures of bedrocks and huge rocks where multiple fish are embedded in the rock. And they said that was sandwiched in there with many tons of pressure to save and capture the fine details. It has to happen instantly. That's the global flood. If you attempt to do that today, you can't create a fossil today.
Can't.
Unless there's a lot of pressure and many tons of pressure, squashing whatever it is that's there. And this has been proven even with a couple of the events that took place in the 80s, Mount St. Helens, and several other events that had happened. They found caps coal miners' caps compressed, and when they would do carbon-argon testing, dating, to get the age of the helmet, 3 to 4 million years. So carbon-argon is not really an accurate method for determining the age. But that stood out to me too when we covered that, when we were, the instructor was showing us. So the Bible is full of stories, and I, like you, Malu, I like the story of Noah. T.S. Eliot gives 3 things to pay attention to. Number 1, plot. This is the plan or main story. Number 2, characterization. Who is involved? What roles do they play? Why are they in the story? Right? And number 3, what are they true to life? What ways are they true to life? This is a little past 215, page 215, 216. Now, what questions does this story raise? What problems do the characters have? What lessons do they learn or not learn? If you start asking these types of questions, you'll go a long way toward understanding what the stories are all about. Can you see how important it is to raise questions to the text? Mm-hmm. See, it keeps a system in place, rather than allowing our mind to wander and ask and answer the unanswerable. If we hit the text with the same questions over and over and over, it forces us to pay attention to what's there. What's a commentary's job? If you have a study Bible, right, you see the bottom notes, what's the job, what's the objective of those notes? What are they trying to do? They're trying to help you understand what's there. Where do you think they're getting the information?
From the text. Nowhere else.
It's subjective, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's subjective if they're not using a system. But if it's objective, it's because they have a system in place, like what we're learning. Mm. And for the most part, these guys go in objectively. But there's also that bias. There's also the denominational tug, the charismatic tug, the evangelical tug. And so a lot of these publishers have a theological slant. Did you know that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So just because you're reading New King James, NIV, you should check out the background of the translating committee. They also have a background. You know, check out where did they go to school. And then you'll notice, oh wow, these guys are kind of liberal in their thinking. No wonder why this is very loose when I read it. Mm-hmm. And then this one is conservative. No wonder why it's wooden. But see, commentaries or the notes on the bottom are designed to help us understand what the text is saying. Now, regardless of whatever their background is, they have a system in place, and they're looking at the text from that framework, mm-hmm. and they're trying to draw from the text and give their 2 cents. And this is why I've said, we're no different than them, except they've devoted their lives in studying the languages, the historical context, and a number of things to help us. But don't get so focused on what they're saying. Get focused on what God is saying first. And see if you can even understand it. And I think we're so accustomed to having it spoon-fed that we don't even take the time to read it for ourselves. Prophet.
Commentaries, for me, the way I use them, mm-hmm. is the least tool that I ever use.
Yeah. Right?
Because if it's the way I look at it, I should be able to deduce my own commentary.
Right.
In essence, my own interpretation.
Right. You should.
Yeah.
And a lot of the scripture is pretty straightforward. Mm-hmm. But there are times where we will have to draw from the expertise of someone who's been there many, many years. Mm-hmm. And they've devoted their life in researching.
So when I go into a book like Revelation, I need a guy who's good with symbolism, who knows not only Revelation, but some of the Old Testament. You know, so if you'll notice, the best commentaries, if you're going to use them, are ones where one person is writing about that particular book, rather than one person who specializes in all 66 books. Mm. See the difference?
Mm. Yeah.
One guy having a commentary for every book of the Bible, obviously he can't master each book of the Bible. So what you're going to get is what's called a running commentary. It's kind of something that we should be able to do. We're looking at the text and we're reading it and we're skimming the surface and we're paying attention to details, who, what, where, when, why, and so we're getting the gist of what's being communicated. It's not necessarily an in-depth commentary, but it's enough to stay on track. Okay? A good example would be Vernon McGee. Vernon McGee is he's an excellent teacher. He graduated from Dallas. He's been dead for a number of years. He's passed on in the 80s, 89, I think. And yet his program continues to air his commentary every single day.
Yeah.
He's got a 5-year Bible bus where you listen to it every day and he's covering section at a time, passage at a time, book by book. And so although he doesn't get into it on an in-depth level, he is true to his system, and he is giving a commentary on Genesis to Revelation based on his studies, based on his expertise, and that goes to show that we should be able to do something similar. We're not going to be able to be in depth on every book, but you can certainly specialize in something as far as reading the scripture, Rafi.
You know who comes to mind in his spoken here?
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that Living Water, the book?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Dr. John Mueller?
Yeah.
I mean, that guy's an expert.
He is.
For the book of John,
yeah.
You know, when he explains the book of John, I've seen him to be the master.
Oh, yeah.
And he's spoken here several times. Yeah. You know?
He's a friend of our ministry, our church, mm-hmm. and I studied with him at Schaefer.
Oh, you did?
Yeah. That's where I met him.
He was your teacher,
yeah.
too?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that's how I got to know him.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he's a really sharp individual when it comes to exegesis mm-hmm. and Greek
yeah.
languages. But his passion lately has been to share and communicate John.
The book of John, yeah.
So his ministry is designed to, you know, expose people to that booklet, mm-hmm. Living Waters. Mm-hmm. That's what he focuses in on. He'll occasionally get in, I'm sure. He goes to these ETS conferences and GES conferences. But, you know, we've had lunch several times and he's shared to me how his passion really is in exposing people to John, because what good is it to really be an expert in understanding all of this when people are not clear on the gospel?
Yeah.
So his direction has been in, you know, pointing people to the book of John, the simplicity of John, mm-hmm. and allowing them to be set free
mm-hmm.
with the gospel message, or the freeness of the message is found in John. Number two, characterization. Talked about that. Number three, what ways are they true to life? And then he talks about parables. The word parable means to throw alongside.
Hmm.
Right? It's a way to communicate truth. You throw it alongside something. I think I used the illustration last week, it's not a parable, but something similar is when you're trying to communicate how something tastes. If someone has never tasted frog legs, for example, I haven't, and you say, well, it tastes like chicken, now they have something to go off of.
Yeah.
They can say, oh, well, okay, I know what chicken tastes like, so therefore, if it's similar to chicken, then it's almost like I've tried frog legs. And God the Son takes life experiences and puts it in story format so that people can learn the spiritual principles that he's trying to communicate. It's a form of figurative language which involves comparisons. Okay? But rather than using a single word or phrase to make the comparison or analogy, a parable is an extended analogy in story form. Look at Matthew, it's rich with parables, right? There are a number of parables. Did you know that there are parables in the Old Testament too?
I didn't know that.
Yeah, there's quite a few parables, even in the Old Testament. We'll look at that one time. On page 218, he says, based on Matthew's account, the parable may have been his preferred method, referring to Jesus, his preferred method for communication.
For teaching.
Yeah. You notice how he taught?
Yeah.
There were moments where he would just talk to individuals, Lady at the Well, Nicodemus. But a lot of times when there are multitudes, he'd say, oh, have them sit down. There was a man, and he'd begin to share a parable, right? So Hendrick says that based on his understanding and what is in Matthew's account, he thinks that it may have been his preferred method of communication.
I think back then also that preferred method of communication was actually easier to do it that way, because the multitude of people coming from different facets of life, it's easier to convey
right
imagery.
Picture form.
Picture form, yeah.
I think you've got a good point there, because a lot of them couldn't read.
Couldn't read, yeah.
So I think in parabolic form, I think that would be easier, imagery. In fact, that's what we're into nowadays, right? We don't read as much compared to 20 years ago.
It's all visual.
It's all visuals. Most books now, if you have the option of reading 200 pages of print or, you know, 250 pages of pictures, you might opt for the pictures, because you can see it, right? We've been so conditioned to seeing things now rather than reading. That's why movies are taking off. The way movies are made nowadays with the special effects, it's designed to get us to respond with all the special effects that are going on. Look at even on computers and TV. The latest thing right now, it used to be Blu-ray. That's not the newest thing now. The newest thing that they're getting into nowadays is, you know, 3D. You know, leaping out at you. And there are cell phones where you can see 3D.
Yeah.
And now, I think it's Sony, they have a 3D computer where you don't need glasses anymore. You just can see it. It's leaping out. It's kind of like Star Wars back in the 80s, or Empire Strikes Back, where what's the guy's name? Obi-Wan Kenobi or something. He stands up in the middle of the room.
Mm-hmm.
That communicates, right? And he's talking. It's kind of like that. It pops out at you. But that seems to be the trend now. Everyone likes to have things almost right there where you can touch it. So parables are an effective form of communication, because as stories, they immediately spark interest in the hearers. Parables encourage people to think. That's very important. Now, I know I mentioned this last week, and I wanted to support my thoughts on this. Remember I'd mentioned that parables, there were times that they were designed to hide or conceal truth?
Mm-hmm.
Turn to Matthew 13, and can someone read 10 to 15?
I'll read it.
Matthew 13, 10 to 15, and listen to what it says.
And the disciples came and said to him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He answered and said to them, Because it has been given to you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. But to them, it has not been given. For whoever has, to him more will be given, and he will have abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken away from him. Therefore, I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. And in them, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled, which says, hearing you will hear and shall not understand, and seeing you will see and not perceive. For the hearts of these people have grown dull, their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes have been closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears, lest they should understand with their hearts and turn, so that I should heal them.
Okay. And the key thing is what the very first thing you read, remember, from 10 and 11?
Uh-huh.
Why do you speak to who?
To them.
Oh, and who's them? The people.
The people.
Right? The multitudes.
Yeah.
You see verse 13, verse 2, great multitudes were gathered together to him so that he got into the boat and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. And then he spoke many things to them in parables.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get to 13, the disciples said, well, why do you speak like this? Why are you talking in story form? And he answered and said to them, because it has been given to you, the disciples, to know the mysteries of the kingdom, but to them it has not been given. I'm not giving it to them. I'm gonna give it to you. I'm gonna explain these things to you. In fact, a lot of times, like the sower and the seed, he explains what the sower, who is the bird that takes the seed?
Mm-hmm.
It's the devil, right? And then the seeds that grew up quickly but then withered away, you know, pressure and all kinds of things. So he would explain it to his disciples, but a lot of times the parables were designed to shield truth from those who were nearby, according to Matthew 13, roughly.
There's some parables too that he's spoken,
mm-hmm.
not so much to educate the Pharisees, but to hide things from the
That's
Pharisees, right?
Yeah.
Because
to hide them.
To hide them from the Pharisees.
Yeah. So, you know, that would create reason to argue with him and
mm-hmm.
delay and prolong his stay. Remember, he was on the move to fulfill the Father's will. And there was already ongoing tension that was growing over the course of time. So a lot of times when he would teach, he's not, if it's a mixed batch, he's going to teach in parables. And the ones that, like this verse says, the hearts of the people have grown dull. And then there are those whose hearts are growing. And it's not that it's getting dull. They're understanding, they're desiring after him, so they follow. They continue to follow where Jesus goes. And those people eventually find, and they learn the truths in time when you read the rest of the parables. He starts to expand in the midst of the multitudes. But sometimes he would purposely shield, and like he says here, it's for you guys to know, but not for them.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to look at who's the them, who's there, and we would have to go back and read probably the prior chapter, aside from 13. So I wanted to show you that there, in the words of Jesus, there are times when he's purposely hiding it. Then there's poetry. This distinctive feature is poetry is its appeal to the emotions as well as the imagination.
Mm-hmm.
And he quotes Psalms 23:1. Maybe you get a little emotional when you read this, especially during certain times.
Mm-hmm.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Right? Where do you hear that? You guys hear that somewhere?
Yeah. I just can't remember what part of a mass or service.
Yeah, when do you hear the pastor quoting this? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
Funeral.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Funeral. It's designed to give comfort. So when, think about it, your job, if you're going to preside the funeral or the viewing, you've got all these people who are sad because of the passing of a loved one. It doesn't matter if they're Christian or not. You can't just say, hey, count it all joy. What's wrong with you? The moment there, every person responds differently. And you've got to match the mood of the group. You would be considered insensitive if you start telling everybody, what's wrong with you? He's just going to sleep. He's in heaven now. He's with Jesus. And you're smiling and you're giggling and they're not. They want to knock you out. Because they said, you don't know how it feels to lose your husband or lose your wife or your son. This is very hard for me.
It has to be appropriate, right?
It has to be appropriate. Yeah. I mean, if the group is rejoicing, then maybe that would be the time to say, okay, well, hey, you're actually okay with the passing of their husband or son or daughter or wife. And maybe they are so focused on the Word and they know that he was struggling with cancer for so long that it's actually better.
Yeah.
And he's a believer, so not only is he no longer in pain, but he's now with God.
Mm-hmm.
So then you can say, you know, you can change it up a little bit and stand with them and be excited as well. He quotes Psalms 46:1, God is our refuge and strength, the very present help in trouble. Have you heard that before?
Mm-hmm.
We sing that at church, right? Most of the Psalms were meant to be sung and not read.
Mm-hmm.
They were composed for worship.
Mm-hmm.
This is the reason why churches incorporate many of the hymns, which are really songs from Psalms.
Mm-hmm.
And God's Word has already provided worship music for us. But this is good for the worship team of local churches. This is the reason why there's always this tension or this discussion on, or even debate on what kind of music should you play.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you don't know, a lot of the Psalms is really songs.
Mm-hmm.
Those are biblical songs. That's why when you listen to the hymns, a lot of times you're sitting here saying, well, I can't really get into that. It's so slow, it doesn't... The old rugged cross? Oh, come on. I mean, but you know, it's rich
mm-hmm.
with doctrine. And it's these things that can impact the person who may need to hear that. You can't go wrong with singing a song that's rooted in God's Word.
Mm-hmm.
That means He approves it.
Mm-hmm.
See? There's no comparison between what we have in Psalms and the songs today. Songs today are good as well. They're part of the spiritual songs that I think Colossians talks about. But even with the contemporary songs today, there's always this, you know, well, should we really use that? You know, and there's discussion even among people who like contemporary music. But you can never go wrong with hymns because God obviously has permitted it to be in His Word. So if we ever are stuck and we're without music, let's comb through Psalms. It's worship music, really. Then there's Proverbs and the wisdom literature. These are short nuggets of truth which are practical and often concerned with the consequences of behavior. Now these Proverbs, the book of Proverbs, they contain principles, not promises. You don't want to quote Proverbs and say, well, God said this. Answer softly, Proverbs 15:1. When you're in a fight with someone, answer softly. And God says the result of answering softly is she will tone down his or her voice. No. That's not a promise. It's basically, it's kind of like, I don't want to... It's like a fortune cookie, almost. You crack the cookie open and it'll give you a practical truth, a life experience truth that may or may not be true. There's other variables that are involved. So they're principles, they're not promises. They tell you how life works. That's all it is. Prophecy and the apocalyptic material or books. This type of literature focuses on future events with tones of warning and judgment. And look at the chart on page 224 to 226. I would encourage you to know these.
Yep.
These are good stuff to know. 224 to 226. The different genres. There's exposition, narrative, oratory, parable, pastoral. What's part of the pastoral genre?
First John.
Okay. Okay, so you've got the examples to the right.
Yeah.
There's poetry, prophecy. So again, it's a handy chart to have, and this will it's additional tools for your library. Sometimes you can even copy this and put it out on your table if you're studying. On chapter 30, he begins to talk about the five keys to interpretation, page 229. And he starts off with Psalms 119:34, "Give me understanding and I shall keep your law. Indeed, I shall observe it with my whole heart." So notice what it says in Psalms 119:34. Give me what?
Understanding.
He's asking God for understanding. Why? That I may keep your law. What's another way of saying that? That I may keep your law?
Or your commandments?
Serve.
To serve?
Observe.
What is that? Oh, observe?
Observe. Follow your commandments.
Follow your commands so that I can keep your commands. I can keep your word. Mm-hmm. How can you apply what you don't know? The key, according to Psalms 119, is in the word understanding.
Yeah.
If a person doesn't have understanding of what he or she is reading, you can't apply it. No matter how nice it sounds, mm-hmm. you cannot use it.
It's almost like, give me understanding of what?
Yeah.
That I may obey what?
Yeah.
Right? So, yeah. Again, the key is understanding, and for understanding, you use the mind.
You have to understand via your mind.
Mind. Yeah.
You have to think things through. And notice the psalmist isn't afraid to ask God for assistance. See? Mm-hmm. The difference between the psalmist and us is that we have the Holy Spirit indwelling us now, mm-hmm. who's one of his primary objectives is to illuminate the scriptures. 1 Corinthians 2. The natural man can't understand these things because the word is spiritual. But the Spirit of God that's in us, he's going to illuminate the scriptures as we look at the scriptures, as we study the scriptures.
Yeah. Just doesn't pop in our head.
He can't illuminate something that's not there. It's like shining a flashlight in our brain and there's nothing there. I'm not saying that you have no brain.
Talk to me about me.
I'm not saying that you have no brain, but if you have no content in the brain, then you can't illuminate that. It can keep shining, but there's nothing there to you, your steward. Mm-hmm. The psalmist realized that apart from understanding, there could be no application of the word. The content of a passage is the raw material with which you will interpret the text. So again, it's always looking at the text. We don't want to do what we used to do years and years ago, which is just, what do you think? We grew up with that mentality and that framework. What do you think? Well, let me close the book and let me tell you what I think. You see, it's not about what we think or what we feel. We have to take our eyes and go back to the scripture and observe. And then once we understand, then we can make application. We looked, page 230, we looked for terms, remember? These mm-hmm. are some of the things that, here's that structure, here's that system. We looked for terms, we looked at the structure, we looked at the literary form, we looked at the atmosphere, we bombarded the text with the who, what, where, when, why, and wherefore, or how. We've been exposed to various strategies aimed at answering the question, what do I see? In the end, you should know what the author is saying. That should be the primary goal of interpreting the scripture. What is the author saying? And once you understand what the author is saying, game on. Now you can apply. But if you don't understand what it's saying, you can't apply it. That's basic common sense, right? If you don't understand what you're cut out to do or called to do at work, you're just going to pace back and forth in your office and your table and say, I don't know what I'm supposed to do. And then when the boss is coming by, you just move around and pretend like you're busy. But you don't know what to do because you don't understand what the responsibilities are for you, right? So what do? You go to the boss, or you go to someone and ask, what is my responsibility? What am I supposed to be doing? It's a humbling experience. And when we think of scripture, when we think of Bible study, it's humbling to say, I don't know what it says. And so we have to go to the person who might have a little more experience, who can shed additional light. And then with this material that we're studying, this book, we should be able to, by the time we're done, have a better understanding of how to approach the scripture. Are we going to master this after we're done? It's going to take a little time. In fact, everything I've listed, terms, structure, literary form, unless you are really, really paying attention and writing notes and listening online, you may not even remember what that is. That's okay. Guess where we got it from? Here. You can always go back. It just depends on how much it means to you. Depends on how much you want to utilize it properly.
You hit that point. So last week I started reviewing chapter one again.
Nothing wrong with reviewing.
Seriously. Because I didn't put in enough time, though. That's what I think.
It's like anything else in life. You want to get good at it, you have to go over it, over it, and over it, and over it. Don't think that just because we've covered this for 14 weeks, you're going to say, hey, I don't need the pastor anymore. I can do this on my own. It'd be nice.
It would be ideal.
But the reality is, you're going to have to go over this more. You're going to have to go over this several times, even after we're done. That's a part of growing. And there's nothing wrong with that at all. Hendricks reminds us once again that the more time you spend in observation, which is what? Observing the text. The less time you'll have to spend in interpretation. That's very, very important. Today, people leap into interpretation without first observing the text. You should read the text, read the passage. When I say text, it could be one verse, it could be multiple verses, it could be the chapter, it could be the book. But read the text. And make sure you can close the Bible and tell someone what you've just read. That's the easiest and simplest way to test what we're learning. You close it and you read it. You read it and then you close the book, close the Bible, and say, okay, what am I going to tell my friend? What am I going to tell my loved one? What am I going to tell my children? What am I going to tell this room full of people who are interested in a Bible study 30 minutes from now? And if you can't, go back and review it and hit it with the questions. Who's in view? What? Where? When? Why? How? I mean, how many of you know that, right? You guys have that mastered right now. Mm-hmm. Who, what, where, when, why, how? Mm-hmm. Start there. I don't know what the literary structure is. I don't know what the genre is. You can still go with the who, what, where, when, why, and how. Mm-hmm. Start there. Once you get fluid with that, once you get comfortable with that, then it starts to make better sense. And then you'll say, oh, you know what, now, what was that genre? Maybe that's right, the genre in Revelation is different. Mm-hmm. It's full of symbolism. It's an apocalyptic book. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can't approach that the way I would approach Romans. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a different book altogether. You know how it is when you read books. the genre of the book is always is different, right? If you are into love stories, that's going to be different from the LA Times, right? Mm-hmm. Different genre. So it's the same thing with books of the Bible. In fact, the Bible is not one book, 66 books. That's good to keep in the back of your mind, especially when dealing with someone who says, well, you're quoting the Bible to prove your case. And that's circular reasoning. But really it isn't. Because circular reasoning is if you're just drawing from one source or one book only. But when you present the fact that it's 66 books, over 40 authors written in different time frames, different parts of the world, that's not circular reasoning, that's evidence. And then you can ask a room full of people and say, stand right there, sit right there. Whisper something in Winston's ear and give a sentence like, okay, tomorrow we will have lunch at the corner of Valencia and El Toro. Pass that on, pass that on, pass that on. By the time it gets to you, sir, it's going to be about the big boat on Dana Point.
Yeah.
Have you ever done that?
Yeah, it's mutating.
It's mutating. Mutating. It never. It doesn't stay true to the original. Mm-hmm. And then you can say, isn't that fascinating, sir, that in this room, this moment, within a span of 10 minutes, we could not hold one sentence from point A to the end.
To true form.
And yet, 66 books is true. The message has stayed through from beginning to end. Isn't that miraculous, sir? We couldn't do it in this room with one sentence. We're talking 66 books. When I quote one and it's supported by another author, that's evidence. You see? So, now this is something that we're familiar with. Page 231, the second key, the next key is context. Context refers to that which goes before and that which follows after, right? We put heavy emphasis here on context. Every major cult is built on a violation of this principle of context. Okay? Let me give you an example of taking something out of context. I've given several in the past. But suppose I said, it's so hot today, I would kill a man just for an air conditioner. What am I saying?
You'll do anything.
You'll do anything more bad. So bad.
But what if you take that literally and you tell someone that I would kill a man?
Then flip out and probably call the cops on you.
Yeah. But see, the context there is that I'm just saying I would do anything to pacify this heat, right? The weather, I can't stand it. I'll do anything for an AC. But when you say something like, oh, I would do anything, I'd kill a person for that, I'm basically saying, I'll do anything to get an AC. It is really, really, really hot, right? That's taking something out of context. When you go and report that to your friend and say, I'm a little concerned about Freddie. He said he would do this for an air conditioner. You see, that's out of context. Those who distort the text many times could be corrected by simply having them read the previous and following verses. Mm-hmm. And how many times have we proven that to be true? Just reading it, right? Before and after. And then he talks about, we're almost done here, several kinds of context. There's the literary context. Acts 1:8 is an illustration of literary context. It's the words before and after verse 8, mm-hmm. right? It's that paragraph. The literary context of any verse is the paragraph of which it is a part of. Mm-hmm. Then there's this, he talks about this historical context. When is this taking place would be an example of the historical context. When? Where does this passage fit in history? What else was taking place in the world at this time? So that's a historical context. Then there's cultural context. The more you know about the ancient culture, the more insight you'll have into the text. So if you go back and do research on the culture of the day, then it'll help. It's like I have American friends, Caucasian, who when they see the kids do mano, they go, "What in the world is that? You're not supposed to bow to anybody." They think that's a form of idolatry. But culturally speaking, that's acceptable. It's a form of respect, right? And so you have to introduce the culture, a piece of the culture, to those who are not exposed or familiar with this. It's not idolatry. It's a very real form of showing respect to the elders, right?
Mm-hmm.
We understand that. But to someone who is outside of the Philippines and does not understand that, they might look at that funny and say, "Ah, what is that?" So that's an example of cultural context. Geographical context. This answers, what was the terrain like? Well, it was windy. The boat was about to sink. What was the weather like? What size city was this? What was the layout of the town? These are different contexts that he's listing, right? Some like to focus in on the geographical context, and so they specialize in this, special resources for this. There's the theological context. What did the author know about God?
Mm-hmm.
Right? David says, "Take not thy spirit away from me." Is there a theological context to that? What would we conclude, especially now? Well, during the time of David, he can say that because the Holy Spirit did not indwell the person.
Mm-hmm.
During the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Jesus said the same thing too. I need to go so that the Spirit would come. He would guide you into all truth and convict the world of its sin. Right? So the Holy Spirit would leave when there was sin during that time in the ancient, Old Testament and up to the Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospel accounts.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, as you know, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, although part of the New Testament or the canon of the New Testament, it was still operating under the Mosaic system.
Yeah.
That's why tithing was in effect. That's why Sabbath was in effect. They were living during that time. So post-cross, after Jesus died, was buried, and rose on the third day, and then he eventually ascended to the Father, started a new dispensation. It's called the Church Age. So, and then he talks about comparison and then the value of a concordance. And by way of closing, let me give you a handout. I wanted to show you what a concordance looks like. Winston, can you? I think you've seen a concordance before, but I printed this out.
This is a strong. It occurred 52 times in the scriptures. Really?
We'll close on this note here.
Tell me where it occurred. Kalinga.
Now, I use an online site for this. Just in case you don't have any Bible software, you can do this online.
Mm-hmm.
I looked up the word believe.
Yeah.
Let's just say, for example, you want to see where the word believe, and remember there's other, there's
four, nine.
Let's see, one, two, four pages, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Is there four?
Five.
Four. When you start in Exodus, and you want to do a word study, you can go and start with Exodus 4 all the way down, and every time the word believe appears, you can find it here, right? Let's say you're saying, well, I know there's a word in Job. There's at least two places where Job, I think the word believe was used. I don't remember the verse.
Job 39:12.
39:12. And not chapter 9, verse 16.
Yeah, 9:16, see?
So have you ever been in a situation where you say, you know, I know the verse, I just don't know where it's at?
Yeah.
And you know what the verse is saying?
Yeah.
You can recite it? You just don't know where it's found. You could take any of those words and do a search on a concordance.
Yeah.
Whether it's the word believe or anything.
Okay.
If you remember, like Winston, do you have a favorite verse?
Trust in the Lord with all your heart.
Okay.
Lean not on your understanding.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not
on your own understanding.
Own understanding. Let's say he wanted to find out where that verse is, and he just, for whatever reason, he doesn't remember.
Mm-hmm.
He could look up trust,
mm-hmm.
understanding,
mm-hmm.
Lord. The problem with Lord is you're going to get a lot, right?
Oh, sir.
Any of those words.
Mm-hmm.
You can search in a concordance, and eventually you'll find it.
Mm.
That's the value of a concordance. And this was taken online, and it's just a simple search on the word
believe.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
See?
The word trust.
So what's the online?
I'm actually, by the time we're done with this class, I'll have several links that I'm going to provide on a handout. And then I'm also going to email it so you can click it, you know, because sometimes it's like fairly long and you get typed www. Oh, what is that? Then you miss one and it's going to route you somewhere else. So I'll send it to you via email, okay? So I hope you enjoyed the class, the session. We'll pick this up next week.
Mm-hmm.
And let's pray. Father, thank you so much for this opportunity where we can study together and learn techniques on understanding your word. We do this not just for academic reasons, Lord. We want to do this so we can know you more and more. Help us, Father, as we commit these things to memory. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. You know, I got this strong